Good afternoon, everyone. This is Caitlin with Banger Inc. And today we are going to be reviewing how to insert or enter new employees that maybe have been hired within your organization. So let's get started. Today, of course, we're going to be operating in a sample company. So none of the information that you see will be real life data. So first we're going to go into the left navigation screen and go to payroll, payroll processing, and employees. This will pop up. This number in the top right, you're seeing number 68, is the next available number that I have in my sequence. So if your company has 500 plus employees, this will generate number 501. Or if you have 5 employees, it will generate number 6. This will always be the number that is next available in your line. Or if you have a different number, if you want to do number 10058, just for kicks and grins, you can always do that as well. The first and last name are obviously required for this information field. Middle name is, or middle initial is optional. And then you'll want to make sure that this is the category that they are. So if they're a current employee receiving payroll, actively involved in the organization, list them as current. Or if any of the other options apply to them, you'll want to update that as well. This goes for all current and past employees to make sure that their status is correct. So when we generate the drop-down list, it will categorize them on this left side of who is a current employee, who has quit, been laid off, terminated, or passed away. So that's a quick way to organize your employees when it comes time for taxes at the very end of the year. So first we are going to insert, I'll even insert my name in here. And we're going to say that I'm a current employee. I promise this isn't my real address, but we'll just make believe for right now. And let's say that I live in Kansas City, Missouri, 64136. So you'll want to insert the address on here. This is very important for when we do taxes at the very end of the year and when we look at Atrix filing. Even though it's not a required field, it's still essential that you put this in there. Next, we'll want to go to human resources. I am obviously going to be a full-time employee, but there are options for part-time and then temporary positions as well. And then I always suggest entering a social security number. Update the gender. Whoops, nope. And if they are a if they have a benefit status, so if they are filing married, you can update that, but it's not a required field as well. Again, none of these right here are required, but this just helps your organization categorize and organize when they hired me. And here you'll want to put your comp code. I want to be clerical today. And then your positions are should already be set. And I obviously want to be the owner. So these required fields need to be entered so we can save the record. If you're needing to add or view records or even change the options that are available, hit that vented arrow and you can edit those, make them available for a new position or a new role. I'm in Missouri, so that's going to be my tax state. And so next we'll move on to the compensation part. And I want to be paid weekly, so this will be where I hit that. Oftentimes, if there are salaried workers, and let's say I make $100,000 a year, because this is make-believe and that's what I want to make, I can hit a weekly and then do salary if I am going to get paid. It looks like that's going to be $19.23 and some change. So I can enter that here. So every time I do a payroll record for a weekly amount, that would be the amount that I get paid. Though I make 100 grand a year, if this is how you want to get paid, this will put in that amount on your payroll record. If you're an hourly person, and let's say I make a bajillion dollars an hour, I can put this weekly, hourly, and then I will classify my hourly pay rate. To be realistic, let's just say I make $50. This will calculate automatically And so overtime is 1.5 and then premium is 2 times. So that'll come into play when we talk about payroll calculations, but this should automatically populate based on the hourly rate. If there's any commission percent or anything that's owed, that would be where you put that. And then vacation and sick are the equivalent of PTO. You only need to put this in one of the categories. Sage just divides it up. But if I am given just 15 days a year and it's a flat rate, not on an accrual basis, you can just enter the 15. Or if I start out with zero, but I can earn at a rate of, I can do per hour or per period. Let's say I earn 1 day per period, per pay period. That's a lot, but let's just say that would be where I entered the rate in the period. And then a maximum. And then if you guys have accruals, that would be where you enter in this information. And if they are eligible to carry over within the next fiscal year of their PTO, that would be where you enter this amount in. So this will always be on every employee record, what they have available. This will automatically update. So if you do pull from their sick time on their payroll record, this will update as soon as you final compute that record. Moving on to the direct deposit. If this is something that I want to elect into, I'll put enable. And then I can put in, I always put active, and then my routing account number. And then this would be if they want all of their pay, how they want to divide that up. So they can do up to 4 accounts and they can divide that up however they prefer. Calculations will show you what I have enrolled in. And so if this is a new employee, hit that save button and these will calculate for the organization. When you're entering in a new employee, it will be blank at times. That's not to say that they are not eligible or responsible for taxes. That is just that it is loading. And so these will pre-populate depending on how your organization has set them up. But this will tell you what they will be deducted for on each pay cycle. Again, additional contacts, not a required field, but definitely can help if you keep track of maybe emergency contacts, children, spouses, anything like that. ACA reporting. So if there is Affordable Care Act reporting needs, this is where you will enter in that information. And then W-4. There have been some changes as of 2020 to the W-4, so make sure that any employee signs and updates the new form. And this is where you will enter in that information. So very standard, if follow down that W-4 and just enter in the information that they've elected for. And then enter the date that they signed it on the bottom. So when you click in these boxes, they will show you on the W-4 what box they are referring to. After this, hoping I've put everything in here I need. I'm going to unclick that one. If I wanted to, if I was wanting to be enabled for direct deposit, it is required that you put in a routing and account number, but I'm going to uncheck that box. And then if they file on their W-4 as married, they will need to, on their calculations page, on their state tax, they will need to elect 2 as their marital status for their state income. Down here in the bottom left-hand corner, it'll tell you the calculations or the numbering scheme that they have. And so I'll need to put 2 if I'm filing as married. After that, you can save the record, and then that employee will now exist in the current field of your employee record. Perfect. That is all there is to it. I know there's a million tabs on there, but after you get through that, your employee is now ready to get payroll set up, have that calculated for, and ready for work. Perfect. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. Please feel free to like and subscribe to this video and this channel. Thank you guys so much.